My name's Steve Johnson, I'm an architect, but I also teach at Bartlett School of Architecture at University College London.
I've been involved in the Woodland Enterprise Centre as an architect after working on a very beautiful grid shell building at the Wealden Downland Open Air Museum in near Chichester. What we've done is built a succession of buildings. I don't know if anybody's been to the Woodland Enterprise Centre. It's semi-public, so anybody can visit anytime you want. I'm not going to speak so much about that because it's a story that's happening already. What I'd like to speak about is this one, which is the old Flimwell Bird Park. So this was given up about nearly 20 years ago, amazingly, and the woodland has started to regrow. And my clients, who are private developers, and this is the most interesting part of the story, they've never done anything like this before. They got the site almost by accident, and we've now got planning permission since just before Christmas. So we've got a Section 106 agreement because it's mixed use, small number of houses, workspace, and a lot of teaching space within this, and that's primary. And this feeds in very nicely these conversations about self-build, and I'll explain why. That is one of the ponds. There are 14 ponds in the middle of this woodland. It's about 50 acres in old money, 25 hectares, 22. That is one of the ponds. So the whole place really needs to be rethought and replanted. So what it's going to be is a partnership, and we're going through this right now. There's a wonderful woman called Jess Steele, who comes from Hastings. She took part in the first meeting we had at the Woodland Enterprise Centre. She has set up a company trying to help people form community projects. So she's working on the pier in Hastings, which is now under reconstruction after it burnt. So that was a community action. So they got crowdfunding to help pay for that work. That is starting. She's helping us because we've never done this sort of thing before. The private developers are very keen for the project to become a public community partnership. So what we're looking at is trying to set up a community trust, and this is open to anybody who's interested, who will take part in the project, both developing it, but then running it once it's going. So we're looking at probably about a five-year project. Who'll be able to use it? Anybody who wants to help, anybody who is going to not do anything bad to the place, hopefully. And what will happen there is that there'll be a small number of people living there, people working directly on the project will be living in two affordable cottages. Students will train there and study there. So anything from this age, even younger, right up to university students. I'll explain the university end of this in a second. People will be working there. So we've got a large workshop and we've got a series of small workshops. What we're hoping for is that artists and craftspeople will move into these workshops. And people who are really skilled, very talented, and draw people toward Flimwell and this region. So if we can get the right sort of people in there, that will draw people in. And it ties into the tourism, the recreational side of it. And then people will just be able to spend time there. So it will be open to the public. The woodland is currently open to the public. Be a bit careful because the ponds are there and we haven't got signage up warning people yet. But that is to come. When will this be happening? Very important question. Now that we've got planning, we will start work on the woodland. So the Forestry Commission are going to be helping us with financing of the removal of a lot of rhododendrons. That's a big problem. But we plan to make use of those rhododendrons for fuel and then convert that fuel, the charcoal, into what's called biochar, which we hope will improve the soils on a not very high-quality soil place so that the woodland will start to produce trees, fuel, and food. That's the big one. Because what we're looking at is how can you start to use high-wield, low-grade soils in order to be able to plant food and trees side by side. We're even looking at the possibility of growing fish within the woodland in a controlled way.
So growing fish.
Growing fish, aquaculture. So it's growing fish and plants side by side in greenhouses. So the fish clean the water, the plants nourish the fish, and it creates a loop. So it's a very interesting project in itself. The woodland, the ponds, as I said, 50 acres, 12 ponds, all to be improved, new permaculture gardens. So we've got a couple who are ready to move in once we build the first house. They will start a permaculture and woodland farming project. They're very experienced. They currently live on a narrowboat. They're very young, and they need a place to live. And they're very experienced. One's a chef, so we're hoping he'll be able to run a cafe restaurant on the site as well. So if you guys come to visit, you'll be able to get lunch on the site. A focal building, quite a large workshop, nearly as big as the largest building at the Woodland Enterprise Centre. And then a group of 8 artisan workshops, all linked by a boardwalk that will run through the trees. It'll be quite fun. A gallery cafe, as I say, to show so the people working there can show their work and sell it in the cafe space. Some student housing, because this is one of the crucial things. Plumpton College come to the Woodland Enterprise Centre. There's nowhere for the students to stay, so they have to move back and forth between Lewis. It's a problem. So what we need to do is create temporary housing for students to be able to stay, and tourists as well, when the students aren't there. 2 project cottages, so they're small, affordable dwellings. This is part of a development to try to show new ways of building truly affordable housing. So this is stuff that people can actually afford to buy. So it's got to be thought in a different way. 3 private homes, which will help finance the project, but these are also homes that need to work with the woodland. It's no good building a little brick cottage in the middle of a woodland because it's got to be able to compete with the trees. So we're looking architecturally at ways to do this, using timber as a primary material. And then energy center, what we're wanting the site to be is as self-sufficient as possible. So it produces its own energy, takes care of its own wastes, and the building's actually part of the growing process within the woodland. What we need to do to make it happen is we need to start getting people involved as soon as we can. So that's school groups, if they're interested, private people who want to take part in helping with the woodland, restoring the ponds. The removal of rhododendrons will be an industrial process because we need to do that, and it's not an easy job. So that will be quite a destructive process. So that's the first thing we'll do. And then incrementally, we have to build buildings, workspaces first, and then we're allowed to build houses, which is very clever, the planners to do, and very entirely sensible. So we'll link the housing with the construction of workshop space so that the site will eventually become occupied 24 hours a day. On the site, we'll have some temporary housing for students as well. This is what it'll look like. So this is the large workshop. So it stands where the existing visitor center ruin was. There's the gallery and cafe space. Here are the 8 workshops. To the what we call tied dwellings. They're not quite tied dwellings, but the people who live in them will be employed by the project to look after the place. And then we've got 3 houses with the energy centre here. And then the 50-acre woodland runs southwest, nearly to the Woodland Enterprise Centre. And this is where the gardening will happen. So if you can imagine, the site will be a green site. So even the houses will have little gardens with them as well. So rather than going off to Safeway or Waitrose, Tesco, to buy your food, people on the site will be able to manage people's gardens as well, if they so choose. But these will all be public, with the exception of this building here. And this is where University College London, hopefully, fingers crossed, touch wood. We're working up plans to turn that into a design and making centre. The university are very keen on expanding into landscape design, rural planning, rather than urban. Everybody talks about urban planning, rural planning, and also the potential for students to be involved in designing, working with communities for self-build projects. We've also got Grown in Britain, it's called, which is now a government or sponsored organization, which is trying to encourage people to make use of UK timber in the construction industry. So what we'd love to happen is for Flimwell to become the center of timber excellence in design and construction, so training construction, training for design, school age up, so from GCSEs, A levels, right through to university. So we can start that happening right on the site. So you can see a picture of Flimwell. What I'm trying to do is feed into this neighborhood plan, is that there's a potential for Flimwell to become a center of excellence and a village that is grown in Britain, which is what this organization would love to see happen. They are promoting viciously a rethink about how British woodland works, and there's no better place for this to happen than right here in the High Weald. That's the large workshop. So you can see these buildings are different form of architecture. This building, for example, has got a propagation greenhouse on the roof. So the building is going to be very low energy, low impact. The top floor will be full of plants. So those plants will be propagated and then taken into the woodland. This is an office on top of the gallery cafe. This is an outdoor classroom. So that could be used for school groups or university groups, but it's also the gateway onto the 50-acre site. So once you go through the building, you're free to roam, practically. These are the workshops. So this shows how the site drops along the boardwalk, which is here. These are small workshops, but we found the Woodland Enterprise Centre. The workshops we built there are a bit too large. So these are smaller to get startup companies. 2 of these we hope will be subsidised by Joe Wood, the Prince's Trust, somebody like that, in order to get young startup craftspeople into affordable accommodation. They'll all be quite low cost anyway. These are the first two cottages. So you can see they're made, they're very simple buildings. The buildings are a growing platform as well, even the little cottages. But roof terraces on these buildings so that people can plant on top of the buildings rather than pitched roofs, which need to be maintained. But they're small and they're very cabin-like. So these could be prefabricated in a large workshop, taken to site and assembled on the site as a package. So that's what keeps the costs down. But there's no reason whatsoever this couldn't happen at the Woodland Enterprise Centre. It could happen at Flimwell Park. It could happen at various contractors' workshops around. And all of this could be linked into training and teaching. So it all works, I think it works really well for some of the recommendations that people made about Ticehurst and Flimwell.
Thank you. Very good.